Our panelists this week include regulars Laura Sanchez, environmental lawyer with the Natural Resources Defense Council, and she's a former executive director of the State Democratic Party. Sophie Martin is a soon-to-be law school student. We're all very proud of you. And managing editor of the social networking site Duke City Fix. Jim Scarantino, he's back from his Colorado wilderness adventure walking the cliff edges of Colorado. He's editor of the online investigative website New Mexico Watchdog. Glad you made it back safe. That's a project of the free market think tank, the Rio Grande Foundation, by the way. Our guest this week, our old friend TJ Trout, radio host and personality with 94 Rock here in Albuquerque, and thank you all for being here, certainly. Now, the governor, guys, says he's looking at a 3% cut nearly across the board to make up for what is now clearly, Laura, a deficit that we have talked about at this table. A lot of folks saw this coming, but there has been a debate between LFC's numbers and the governor's numbers. We have the LFC numbers now. Let me ask you the first question. Was he perhaps a little hasty in response, just saying, well, I can solve this. Let's just cut 3% across the board. Is that creative problem solving here, or are we still kicking that can, as they say?
Well, I mean, that certainly sounds like we're kicking the can, but I can't imagine. I mean, it wasn't a reactive statement, I don't think. I mean, I think the writing was on the wall. As you see the projections of potential revenue coming in, you've seen the government, the state basically decide to have this amnesty for tax relief as an effort to try to raise more money, to bring some $7 million back into the state coffers. I don't think that it was something that was a reactive statement. Mm-hmm. It probably had been thought out at some level. Probably was something that it might have even been on the table last session. But I don't think it's enough. I think part of the problem is nobody seems to be realistic about what we're talking about here. The projections have come in at this point. They're probably going to get worse. It's probably going to get even worse before we actually figure out where to cut and what to do. So I think everything, from my perspective, should be on the table. I think there's a lot of money that's left on the table often because we still have a form of underpayment of corporate taxes. And I also think that the governor's getting criticized for not having passed that or signed that GRT food tax mm-hmm. into law. And I still support, I still think it's a good idea because it basically took the burden off of the poor people in the form of food. So somebody's going to have to bear a burden, whether it means shrinking state government or adding additional revenue. Mm-hmm. But I don't think everybody's being realistic about what needs to happen.
Sure. Jim, you've been very strong on this at this table. What's your take on the numbers first and then the reaction and what we do second?
Well, yesterday, the day before the taping of this in the Legislative Finance Committee, it was revealed that the governor's projections once again were way, way off the mark. He has been completely unrealistic. We're going on 2 years now. We've had this conversation mm-hmm. with John Arthur Smith saying this is how bad it's going to be, and Governor Richardson going, oh, no, you know, all these, you know, doomsayers. He underestimated next year's revenues by over $100 million. This budget that they threw together recently was based on 6% growth projections, which everybody knew were unrealistic. So the first thing they need to do is get realistic and go into the session and go into their policy making, being objective and honest about where things are. The nice thing that we're seeing now is everybody except the public sector unions and the governor, including Diane Dennis, Susana Martinez, the governor's advisory committee on government efficiency, all realize that our oversized public payroll is smothering growth. Mm. And they're all calling for shrinking it by various means, attrition, buyouts, et cetera, et cetera. That is simply going to happen because we cannot sustain things where they are. One other element is they've plugged holes with federal stimulus.
Right.
It's like chewing gum, and there's no more chewing gum to plug those holes. So they kicked that can down the road. And the third piece that they have not paid attention to is really stimulating the private economy. We've seen all sorts of things done to keep the public sector where it is, to keep it cushy, to avoid this problem here for these public sector employees. We're not going to turn this around until state government does something mm-hmm. to let the private sector generate the jobs and revenue.
Sure. But TJ, we've got an outgoing governor.
Right.
And can we reasonably expect him to take that kind of approach that Jim's talking about or just leave it for the next governor?
The thing that kills me about this, the whole thing's been politicized. I mean, it really has. Yeah. I mean, I think he's making grand expectations of what's actually going to happen. And it's not going to happen. And number one, I don't think any of these people actually know what's going to happen because it's all based on the not only these, not the state economy, the federal economy, mm-hmm. and the world economy. Mm-hmm. And I will actually give Bill Richardson a break here. And the reason I do this is, I know, I see what you're looking.
Yeah,
you're giving me the look.
I'm waiting to hear this.
No, I'm going to give him a break because this ultimately is not his fault. It really is not his fault. I mean, there are things he could have done to make the situation better in New Mexico. Mm-hmm. But this all is on what happened a couple of years ago worldwide and federally. I mean, they didn't see it coming. We didn't see it coming. Obviously, his state, he's got a lot of people working for him. If you compare his regime to Gary Johnson's regime, it's night and day. Right. They can do a lot of things to get the cost down. Mm-hmm. However, I don't like this being politicized so much and all the finger pointing of saying it's all on him, it's all on him, it's all on Diane Dinesh. It's not. It's that we are being rolled along like a giant ball. What is happening in the world and in just in the rest of the country.
Sure. But we've grown the state budget by $2 billion.
True. I understand.
That is a fact.
We also, though, in this last legislative session, I think if you look at the numbers now with some hindsight, we had only $180 million in tax cuts, increased tax revenue. Did I say that right? I feel like I've got that one backwards. But we cut $800 million from the budget and then plugged some holes with some federal money came our way because of stimulus. We cut from our state budget already $800 million. When you look at the balance between the 180 and the 800, mm-hmm. conservatives got an awful lot in that legislature compared to what progressives might have wanted to see in terms of making sure that social services were in good shape so that when people did lose their jobs, they had access to mental health services, to regular health services, to an unemployment department that would pick up the phone when you called and you had a problem with your issues. When you look at those numbers, you know what? We did cut, and all we can ever talk about at this table is cutting again. Mm-hmm. And the question becomes, at what point do we look to corporations, right. to our wealthiest citizens, et cetera, and say, guys, you got to pony up your share here. Yeah. And I have to say as well, we keep hearing on the national level, on the state level, that it's all about reducing our expenses. This is a state where you cannot turn it around in 1 year, two exactly. year, 3 years. We are dependent on federal funding. Mm-hmm. We're dependent on state's expenditure. And to say, cold turkey, we're cutting all these people off the payroll, we're cutting all these services, we're getting rid of all this stuff, that's death spiral as
sure.
far as I'm concerned.
Sure. And now that brings us to revenue generation, which some people would call taxes.
Let's call it taxes.
And Laura, Sophie brings up a good point that we've discussed at this table, a lot of people have, about the tax rate on the rich, whatever you want to classify the rich. Does that have a chance of moving somehow? And a lot of folks don't think that's going to solve everything. But if everything's on the table, should we start looking at that? And is the governor able to do that at this point?
Well, I think it's a political, definitely a political third rail. I mean, mm-hmm. you touch that and it becomes very difficult to get it passed. So, mm-hmm. Should it be on the table? I think I think everything ought to be on the table because that's the best way to potentially share the burden across all classes and have everybody sort of in some way be impacted, mm-hmm. as opposed to putting the burden disproportionately on any one class. Mm-hmm. The problem with doing it only on the highest income earners in the state is that it becomes, those are the people who typically are best represented at the legislature. Mm-hmm. Somebody is speaking for them, somebody's speaking for the corporation. They have the lobbyists to dissuade lawmakers from going that route. So I think it does need to be taken out to the extent that we can. We're still in New Mexico politics, of course, but taken out of the political fray and really sit down and determine where the best cuts need to be made across the entire board.
10 seconds, if you want to finish
okay,
this.
I may sound like an ultra-Republican. The people with the money are the people that create the jobs in the state, and those and I don't think they should be unfairly taxed. Number two, if you want this to be equal, I've always been in favor of put a cent or two tax on gasoline, energy. Uh-huh. And make it temporary. Don't make it permanent. Make it temporary to raise the money.
I hear your thoughts, Jim. I'm just going to channel
temporary
you.
Tax? What's
Never
that?
Happens. It always stays. Now, we've got much more to get to here on This Week on the Line, including the controversy over the death of a little girl who was left in a hot car for several hours. Now, what punishment is fair for her mother? We'll discuss that question right here at this table.